And good evening, folks, and welcome again to another episode of the Laird Subjects. I'm the Laird, and tonight we're going to be discussing Fortitude, Episode 7. So what is Fortitude? Fortitude has a different meaning to many different people, not just myself, but others included. Fortitude, as defined by Webster-Merriam Dictionary, is courage in pain or adversity. Also, the mental strength to keep moving forward in difficult situations. So what does fortitude mean to me? There's many different things that we call fortitude. A lot of people don't use the formal term fortitude. They'll say things like chutzpah, or they'll say one of the more common is intestinal fortitude. Men have a crude way of saying fortitude. They might say, well, that person needs to have testicular fortitude, also commonly referred to as balls. So, what is fortitude? Fortitude, basically, is the drive to carry on when, quite frankly, you don't see any reason to carry on. Fortitude is that thing that you have that comes through when you feel that you've done everything you can, but you know you still have to keep pushing forward. And that could be in anything in life. That could be your job. That could be family. That could be running into a problem. You didn't get the promotion you wanted. You came up short in paying your rent or your payments on your car or something like that. So you're trying to find a way to get through that. And you have to have the courage to get through that. Some adversities I've faced, contrary to popular belief, even with a name like the Laird, I have had some very rough go-abouts. I have made poor decisions that have led me to have to rely on my fortitude to get through things. some of those decisions have been faults of my own. Some of those decisions have been forced upon me. But regardless, I still had to have the fortitude to get through it. I still had to focus on what was more important, to have the drive to get to the other side. When I think of mental fortitude, I think of what it took for me to get through something like Marine Corps boot camp. Any Marine that has ever gone through that boot camp or officer candidate school or any type of Marine Corps training, and I'm sure that there's plenty of examples in the other services. However, I have to rely on my own experiences, and my experiences are mostly with the Marine Corps. To get through something like that, it takes a lot of mental fortitude. It's not so much about what you can do physically. Yes, it helps to go to any military boot camp, and especially the Marine Corps, in great physical condition. However, that's not really what gets you through those tough times. That's really nothing that, even in the military standpoint, that they're really looking for. Anybody, and I do mean anybody, physically can be broken down enough and worked into enough to be able to meet the standards that are required for you to pass not just your physical fitness tests or your physical abilities tests, but to be able to get what you need to do your job, depending on what your job duties are. That is something that even the best drill sergeants, drill instructors, technical instructors, that's what the best of them will tell you. The real fortitude, the real test in any type of military training is to test your mental fortitude. They want to see what you're going to do when you do not have anything left in the tank, so to speak. They want to see what drive and how you're going to come over those challenges and what you're going to do to better yourself and to better those around you and how you're going to react. How are you going to treat people when your back's against the wall? Are you going to be a leader or are you going to be a follower? To be a leader, it takes fortitude. Not that it doesn't take fortitude to be a follower as well, but if you want to lead people, whether it be your family, whether it be people in your career, you have to have fortitude. So, as a listener, think about what fortitude means to you. Think about a time where fortitude has helped shape your life, where you decided you're going to work through something, even though it may be painful, even though it may be very difficult. Think of a time where that, having that type of mental toughness, if you will, that mental fortitude, to be cliche. Think of a time when having that got you through a rough time and how much easier life was on the other side. Think for another moment of another example when fortitude would have helped you, but you failed to use fortitude for one reason or another. Maybe you thought it was just too tough. Maybe you just thought you couldn't do it, and you beat yourself up and you let yourself down. Can you remember, or think, I should say, about how you would have felt if you would have just stuck with it? I think all of us have been there at some point in time. All of us have some form of regret in our life that maybe a little bit more mental fortitude would have been able to push us through. Maybe a little bit more mental toughness would have been able to help us through. Louis Nazir once said, "I know of no higher fortitude than stubbornness in the face of overwhelming odds." No higher fortitude than stubbornness. Let's think about that, just that section for a minute. People who have a high fortitude, they're very stubborn. When I think of stubbornness, I can think of none other than my grandmother. She's 95 years old this year, by the way. She'll be 96, actually, before the year's out. And she is so stubborn. She is the classic example of a stubborn farm woman. But then when I look back on what she had to go through in her life, the things that she saw, the things that, quite frankly, she can't remember anymore. And I look at that and I think, wow, the amount of fortitude that she had to have, the amount of stubbornness she had to have in order to get through those, to get to where she's at today. The things that she had to do to become and to make our family, not just my mom or my dad or me, our entire family, where they were. Now, don't get me wrong. Grandpa had a big part to do with that, but we're talking about my grandmother at the moment. So the amount of stubbornness that she had and how that helped her get through. I can only imagine the overwhelming odds that she saw in her time. I mean, we're talking, she lived through the Depression, all those things, just to be able to get to where she is today, to be able to have a grandson that has his own radio station, does his own podcasts, went into the military, another grandson who was a great baseball player, even drafted at one point in time to play Major League Baseball, who eventually went on to become a 21-year law enforcement veteran and is now teaching and coaching at the high school level back home, to have a granddaughter who runs a television program, to have another granddaughter who's traveled the world, been to places like New Zealand, helped out in major museums in the Washington, D.C. area, as well as state museums in the Midwest. To think about the stubbornness that she had to come over to, the fortitude she had to have just to give us the fortitude to do what we needed to do. Now, Louis Nazir, for those who don't know, was a Jewish-American trial lawyer. He was born in London, and he later immigrated to the United States with his parents. At one point in time, and now this is during the early 1920s, he was the highest-paid lawyer in the world, not just in New York or some other place in the United States, in the entire world. And you can find that in the Guinness Book of World Records. So to be someone who immigrated to the United States at the time that he did, to become the highest paid lawyer in the world, that right there is enough to show you what kind of fortitude that he had to have, what kind of drive he had to do. Think about the adverse conditions he had to come through. To be a Jewish American in those days was not a very good thing in America. He faced a lot of issues coming up. Some of the people that he represented throughout his career, people like Johnny Carson, Salvador Dali, Mae West, even Dr. J himself, Julius Erving. He originally came to prominence during the McCarthy era when broadcaster James Henry Falk was accused of being a communist. He successfully defended Mr. Falk, which started a downfall in the accusations leaned against many people of that day. Nazir is also credited with helping form the motion picture rating system by the Motion Picture Association of America that is still used to this day to rate films. So when you see a film and it says it's rated PG, PG-13, R, he helped initiate that. Now, granted, some of those ratings have changed since his day, but he helped start something like that. So every time you go see a movie, every time you see a preview and it says something about this preview has been approved for general audiences by the Motion Picture Association of America, this movie is rated PG-13, this movie is rated this, he helped start that. Now, some people would argue, well, that's kind of censorship and things like that, and that's something else that we could talk about on another day. But the fact that we're talking about a person who had an impact so long ago that we even see it today in 2021, and we're definitely going to see it into the future. Just that alone shows enough of his accomplishments and what he had to work through and what he has done. He also wrote the foreword for the Warren Commission report, which was the report that was generated after the JFK assassination. So just this person right here, just to give another quick summary, born in London, immigrated to the United States, represented people like Johnny Carson, Salvador Dali, Mae West, and Dr. J, was the highest paid lawyer in the world, and he even wrote the foreword for the Warren Commission. That right there, just one of those, or even two of those, for most of us, would be enough for us to hang our hat on and say, we did a good thing, we had a good life. But this man had the fortitude, the stubbornness, to overcome those overwhelming odds. Now, when you think about what he had to do and what kind of fortitude he had to have, think about how that would relate to your life. What type of obstacles do you have that are stopping you that fortitude can get you through, that mental toughness can get you through? Are you facing as many obstacles as Mr. Nazir? Fortitude is the marshal of thought, the armor of the will, and the fort of the season. Francis Bacon. Now, this is reaching way back into history. But Francis Bacon, he was the Lord High Chancellor of England and the Attorney General of England and Wales at one point in time. He had to overcome a lot of obstacles. He was in politics at a time when politics were quite literally much more brutal than they are today. I mean, don't get me wrong. We do have some things that go on in politics today that are pretty bad. But we're talking people back then. It was quite literally, in a lot of cases, cutthroat. In his case, Francis Bacon, his political career ended in disgrace in 1621. After he fell into debt and was charged with 23 counts of corruption. Now, the people who charged him with those counts of corruption were his political rivals. The same people who didn't like him for his political belief systems were the ones that said, hey, this guy's corrupt and he's in debt. He was obviously found guilty because the people who charged him were also the people who were the jury, if you would, for him. and he was fined 40,000 pounds. Now, we think of 40,000 pounds in today's standards, and we hear that number, and we go, oh, 40,000 pounds. You know, that's still a lot of money, but to put it in perspective, 40,000 pounds in 1621 is the equivalent to 162.1 million pounds today. That's 224.2 million American dollars in today's money. Could you imagine being a politician? You don't even have to be a politician. It could be anything. And they come back and they tell you, hey, by the way, you owe us 162.1 million pounds for those of you in the UK, or for those of you in the US who are listening to this, 224.2 million dollars. Think about what would be running through your head at that time. Think about how you would feel about your life. On top of that, he was also sent to the Tower of London. Now, most of us, no matter which side of the pond we're on, we know what it means to be sent to the Tower of London. We've heard the horror stories. If you haven't, it's an easy look up on anything. You can look it up on Amazon. You can look it up on YouTube. It doesn't matter. You can find in all kinds of books on the Tower of London and the atrocities that happened there. However, King James I eventually commuted his sentence and did not make him pay that fine. You talk about a sigh of relief. Could you imagine how you would feel if you had all these burdens upon you? They were placed upon your head. They sent you to the Tower of London. They said, hey, you owe us millions of pounds, millions of dollars. We're not talking one or two. We're talking hundreds of millions. And then the king, or in if you're in the United States, the president, comes and says, you know what? Don't worry about your sentence, and don't worry about the fine. Could you imagine the sigh of relief you would have? Now we got to talk about where his fortitude came into that. Sir Francis Bacon knew that these allegations that were thrown against him were erroneous. However, he did admit to them because he did fall into debt. He took responsibility for the things that he did do wrong. So even though a lot of these were trumped up charges, he still took responsibility for those that he did do, and even the ones that were levied against him, just to add on top. So imagine the fortitude he had to have to say, you know what? Yes, I am in debt. Yes, I did do some of these things, and I am guilty of some of these things. Keep in mind, not everything. Imagine the fortitude that it took to admit that, knowing that the same people who despised him were going to be the ones that were going to carry out judgment and sentence against him. And he still said, this is what I did wrong. How many of us would do that? And still no guarantee that King James, or any monarch for that matter, would commute his sentence. That's a little bit of luck for him. That was a lot of luck for him. Because the king could have easily said, you know what, I don't want to go against what is now the new political power in Parliament and anger Parliament against me. Because these were early days of Parliament. There was a lot of fighting between the monarchy and the Parliament in those days. Pray for intestinal fortitude. Work hard and keep the faith. Oh, and pray for good luck. You're going to need it. That was said by Jerry Reed. Jerry Reed was a musician who wrote many songs that we still enjoy today, like Eastbound and Down, the theme song from Smokey and the Bandit. He's also a member of the Country Music Hall of Fame. So let's think about that. This one's based a little bit more on faith. And for those of you who are non-faith-based in there, just listen to the lesson. Pray for intestinal fortitude. In other words, ask for it. Ask to have the intestinal fortitude. Work hard, pretty self-explanatory, and keep the faith. Oh, yeah, and by the way, pray for good luck. You're going to need it. Now, I think that a lot of us would agree that luck, some of us, especially if you're in my case, if you don't have bad luck, you don't have any luck at all. But he's saying there, have the drive, push through, always keep pushing through, no matter what, which is where the keep the faith comes in. And you're going to need a little bit of luck. Sometimes just having the fortitude isn't enough to get you through everything. Sometimes you got to, for lack of a better term, the proverbial break. Oh, I got to catch the break. I got to catch a break. Sometimes that proverbial break or that luck, sometimes that helps. So when we think about how fortitude helps us, would it be a safe argument to say that having fortitude can sometimes create good luck? If people know that you're mentally tough and that you have a lot of fortitude and that you're going to push through and that you're going to keep going through something, how many people think that somebody notices and somebody might reach out and help you? Could be a friend, could be a church, could just, for lack of a better term, be a lucky break. It could be any of those. But fortitude is something that can't be taught. It can't be brought up. It can't be something that you learn in a classroom. It is one of those lessons that you have to learn through the example that is placed before you. Whether that be in a parental figure or a mentor or just somebody that you know that you admire and you look up to. Any type of role model. I learned a lot in those first years in Miami while struggling just for survival and by observing my father's fortitude. It's Desi Arnaz. So Desi Arnaz is quoting that where he got his fortitude from, where he got his drive, where he saw the lessons that you can't learn in a textbook. He observed them from his father. That's how people learn fortitude. That's how people learn mental toughness. I would argue that fortitude is a social skill that you can learn over time and through example. And you can't learn it anywhere else. I've said several times already, you can't learn it in a textbook. Yes, you can look up in the dictionary and see what fortitude means in black and white words. But if you've never seen fortitude, or if you don't have it, you do not know what fortitude means. Desi Arnaz is best known for his role as Ricky Ricardo on the I Love Lucy show with Lucille Ball. That's where most of us know him. However, he was also a musician. Very popular musician, actually. And he has a very good rags-to-riches story. Actually, he went riches to rags, rags to riches. He did a full circle. Full 360. The only way anybody can reach that full 360 is to have that fortitude that drives them to do what they need to do. That mental toughness, that never give up, that never say die attitude. That is ultimately what fortitude is. Arnaz was born in Cuba. His father was one of Santiago's youngest mayors, and he also served in the Cuban House of Representatives. Not Arnaz, his father did. His maternal grandfather was an executive and rum producer at Bacardi and Company. Most of those folks who have watched any TV commercials know exactly who Bacardi and Company is, because it's still a company that operates today. Arnaz's family owned three ranches, a palatial home, and a vacation mansion on a private island in Cuba. So think about that. He was definitely born into privilege. His father was a prominent politician. He was a mayor. He was a House of Representatives, or he was in the Cuban House of Representatives. His grandfather was an executive at Bacardi and Company, which ships alcoholic beverages throughout the world. They own three ranches, a home, a palatial home, and a vacation mansion. Now that is born into privilege, if I've ever heard it. However, following the Cuban Revolution of 1933, Arnaz's father was jailed and all their property seized. So no more mansions, no more palatial homes, no more ranches, no more private island. It was all seized by the Cuban government. His father was released 6 months later when his brother-in-law intervened. The family then fled to Miami, and in the summer of 1934, Arnaz attended school near Tampa in order to help improve his English. So he lost all these things. Well, his family did. His family lost all these things. Dad goes to jail. They're lucky enough that they had enough influence to get him out of jail, and then they flee to Miami, Florida, to start a new life with nothing. Remember, this is a family that's used to privileges. Ranches, homes, mansions, private islands. These are some things that, even with all the fortitude that we have, most of us will never accomplish. And that's fine. But imagine having it and then losing it. Goes to a country where he doesn't speak very good English. So they enroll him in a school near Tampa. For anybody who knows where Miami and Tampa is, that's literally the other end of the state, in order to help improve his English. Arnaz's first job was at a Woolworths in Miami. He worked there until he went into the tile business with his father, which he helped his father with until he finally was able to make it into show business full time. So imagine all that fortitude that he had to have, all that mental toughness. Now, some of us, fortitude comes from the fact that we don't have much, or we don't have anything in some cases, and we have to have that fortitude in order to get the things that we want. We have to have that mental toughness to get the things that we want. So imagine for a second having all the things that all the want in the world. Homes, ranches, palaces, private islands. Losing it and then being mentally tough enough to go get it all back on your own. Because those who know Desi Arnaz, obviously not now, he's no longer with us, but those who have followed his career, even could look up his career, can see that he had a very, very good life. He married Lucille Ball. They started their own production company, Desi Lou Productions. They even innovated the syndicated rerun, something that at the time was not popular and, when was brought up to many executives back then, was predicted to fail. Imagine if we didn't have syndicated reruns of old television shows today. Some of the shows that you grew up with, you couldn't rewatch again after their first air. Many of us, especially if you have a Netflix or an Amazon account, many of us binge watch shows hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times. Without Desi Arnaz and Lucille Ball, that wouldn't have been possible. That was a new concept. So think about that mental fortitude. Now, what I'm going to play for you here is a clip from the movie Rocky Balboa from 2006. Many of you will know this clip. It's one of my favorite clips to go to whenever I'm having a tough time, or whenever I'm thinking about fortitude or something along those lines. And I like the message that's behind it. You know, Sylvester Stallone, not only is a great actor, but the people who wrote this, including himself, they have a lot of things and experience in life that do come out in writing particular lines like this one. And I want you to listen to it, and I want you to think about it. And I want you to really think about it. And if you have to, this is a podcast. You can rewind it and play it again and again and again. But I want you to listen, and I want you to think about what these words mean to you.
I already know. The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is going to hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, now go out and get what you're worth. But you got to be willing to take the hits and not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you want to be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that.
I think that arguably is one of the most powerful scenes in that entire Rocky series. But let's think about what he's talking about there. Let's break it down just for a minute. What he's really talking about there is mental, and in a lot of cases, considering the material for the films, he's talking about mental and physical fortitude. I love the line in there where he says, life will hit harder than anybody ever. And it's true. If you think about physical fights and you think about the physicality of those kinds of things, whether you've ever been in one or not, is irrelevant. Would it be worse to get punched in the face or for something horrible in your life to happen? Granted, nobody wants to get punched in the face, but you're definitely going to recover a lot faster than if something comes out and you lose your job or something you were counting on to happen didn't happen. Or, in most cases that we see in most examples, something that you didn't expect to happen does happen. Whether it be the loss of a loved one or someone who you relied upon for income or whatever the case may have been. Fortitude is exactly what Sylvester Stallone, playing the character of Rocky Balboa, is talking about there. It's not about how hard you can hit. Because I've met some people that can hit pretty hard, and I'm not talking about physically, I'm talking about just period. But it's about how hard you can get hit and keep getting up. That reminds me of another line from Rocky II, actually. When Apollo Creed's trainer's talking to him, and he's telling him he doesn't want to take on Rocky anymore, he shouldn't do it again, it's bad for his career, it's scared of him. And Apollo asks him to explain himself, and he said, I've never seen a person. You hit him with everything you've got, and he kept getting up. You would hit him again, and he kept coming after you, and we don't need that in our life. Now, of course, he's talking about the fact that, you know, here comes Rocky Balboa. If Rocky keeps doing that, he is going to take the title from Apollo Creed. But isn't that exactly what most of us are trying to do when it comes to fortitude? Not in the nefarious way of, well, we're going to take something from somebody, but we've got to keep going. We got to keep driving. We got to keep pushing and pushing and pushing. And that's exactly what the entire Rocky series is about. It's about fortitude. Yes, physical fortitude, but mostly it's about mental fortitude. When somebody tells you you can't do something and you do it anyways, when somebody tells you that it's too hard, and you say, I think I'll handle it from here. Fortitude is what makes the difference between you and the person who doesn't want you to succeed. The person who doesn't want you to succeed hopes that you lack the fortitude to be able to succeed. No matter where you are in life, no matter what has happened to you, fortitude is going to be one of the many factors it takes for you to overcome any obstacle. And I don't care what that obstacle is. Fortitude is going to be what gets you over the hard part. Easy is on the other side of hard. Easy is on the other side of hard. You have to go through the hard in order for things to get easy. And then I got something else for you. Once things get easier, something else that's hard gets in your way. And you got to repeat the step over and over and over again. But that's what fortitude is. It's having that mental toughness, that ability to keep pushing forward when even you don't think you can. I appreciate you listening to the Laird Subjects tonight. Available on all podcast platforms officially. Whether you like Apple, or whether you like Amazon, or whether you like Spotify, or of course the Podbean app, which I highly recommend. Lots of good podcasts on that app. I would also like to announce that on top of having the podcasts, I've also started my own radio station, KLAI Rock Mix, available on the Live 365 app. We play rock music, requests, play some heavy metal along with some new artists. I also want to announce that we will be moving the live podcast show, Open Air with the Laird, to KLAI, so it will no longer be available on the Podbean app. So if you do wish to hear Open Air with the Laird, as I will have guests from all different walks of life. Last week's guest was an artist that I know out of Atlanta, Georgia. And we discussed many topics ranging from current news and current events to, well, we even had a little bit of a preview of this podcast where we talked about fortitude. I ask that you download the Live 365 app and save KLAI. It's not hard to spot. Green letters, KLAI, with a skeleton wearing a kilt, playing bagpipes. It's pretty iconic, if you ask me. And I also thank you for listening to the Laird Subjects, as we will continue to bring this podcast every week, available on Sundays on your favorite podcasting platforms. I thank you very much. This has been the Laird, and I hope that you all have a very fortuitous day.